Hello, my name is Robin Hisme, and I am pleased to present a brief introduction to William Shakespeare's The Taming of the Shrew for the Shakespeare 2020 project. Shrew is one of Shakespeare's earliest comedies, composed and performed in the early 1590s. Shakespeare calls upon a variety of other texts and literary conventions in his remaking of this popular shrew plot. His version reverberates with many sociocultural discourses circulating in late 16th century England, including the status of women, marriage arrangements, marital relations, household governance, and social roles. I'd like to discuss how the play exposes tensions in those areas, approaching through the features of this play, which are particularly unique, the induction scenes at the beginning, the marriage ceremony in the middle, and the less than harmonious conclusion at the end. In the induction scenes, the lord of the manor finds a poor drunk tinker passed out on the ground and brings him home. Decked out in finery and served delicious delicacies, Christopher Sly is persuaded that he is in actuality a gentleman who has suffered delusion for many years. When the male page Bartholomew is instructed to dress as the new lord's wife, Sly immediately, hilariously, tries to usher him to bed. Although he is told that he must abstain for health reasons, Sly and Bartholomew sit to watch a group of traveling players perform the events in Padua. While this start might seem bizarre and unrelated to the marital fortunes of the Baptista sisters, the themes of identity and transformation, manipulation and trickery, disguise and confusion are all similar. These scenes, with their focus on the Lord's manipulations, heighten our awareness of the conventions of theater, even as they alert us to parallels with the Italianate characters. The Lord and Petruchio have some things in common. The main plot follows the courtship and marriage of two sisters, although undoubtedly foregrounding the shrew, Catherine. The eldest daughter of Baptista Minola, Catherine is denigrated by a host of men because of her sharp tongue, while her younger sister Bianca is adored and courted by several suitors. Baptista's insistence that Catherine marry before he allowed Bianca to wed leads Bianca's suitors to collaborate on finding a husband for cursed Kate. Enter Petruchio, a wealthy young man wandering the world in search of his fortune. He is the proverbial fortune hunter. Unmoved by the reports of Catherine's unruliness, his only care is to obtain her dowry. And so the subsequent wooing and marriage to Kate is established as an economically motivated arrangement with Kate as commodity. On the other hand, the subplot of Bianca's courtship is indebted to the Petrarchan model of courtly love, with suitors vying to serve an idealized mistress. By intertwining these two types of amatory relationships, Shakespeare can interrogate the conventions and expectations of each and explore a topic he undertakes in many other plays. Who gets to arrange marriages? Parents or children? And what are the criteria? Should you marry for money or for love? Well, don't look for any clear answers here, as there are unexpected and perhaps ambivalent outcomes to each union. But let's jump to the wedding. Rather than occurring in the concluding scenes of the play, as with most comedies, the marriage between Petruchio and Catherine occurs in the middle. This provides an opportunity to explore not only courtship, but the relations between husband and wife. Marriage in English society was considered central to social order and essential for the spiritual health of its participants. There was, however, tension between the patriarchal model of the male as head of the household and the encouragement of the idea that a woman was a helpmeet or a partner to the marriage. While we can find many conduct books offering marital advice, the question of whether a woman was partner or subordinate is vexed. At the very least, though, husbands and wives were encouraged to try and get along, finding compromises if necessary, as divorce was not an available option. Petruchio's tardiness to the wedding and his bizarre attire are only preludes to the mad and irreverent behaviors during the ceremony. These actions are shaming rituals, where Petruchio is subjecting Catherine to public humiliation as a disciplinary tactic. His taming strategies continue to escalate after the wedding, but are undertaken in the privacy of his household, until reaching the climactic moment where she is forced to call the sun the moon at his behest. And this section, for many readers, is where the comedy turns dark. Indeed, modern spectators are hard-pressed to see beyond the scenes of deprivation and mental domination to which Catherine is subjected. Despite the Italianate setting, this segment of the play has much more in common with contemporary tales related in English ballads and broadsheets depicting shrews and scolds and the methods undertaken to discipline them. We can point to an increase in the prosecution of women for a range of various crimes, including disorderly speech. Scolds, shrews, witches were often ducked on cucking stools or made to wear scolds' bridles. Men who failed to control their wives could also be subjected to shaming rituals and public discipline. Why is there such anxiety surrounding the figure of the unruly woman? Well, one answer lies in the concept of the household in early modern England. In the system of correspondences which governed political thought, the microcosm of the household was analogous to the macrocosm of the state, and order in the small commonwealth was essential to the broader social and political order of the large one. It was the duty of the patriarch to keep order and discipline among his subordinates, which included not only his spouse and children, but also any servants, tutors, or apprentices who worked with the family. The use of physical force was understood as necessary and even helpful means to secure obedience. This is evident not only with Catherine, but with the many servants in the play who are beaten with impunity. Although most comedies conclude with several seemingly companionable marriages, this play does not. Petruchio wins a wager when Kate admonishes Bianca and the widow for their lack of obedience and demonstrates her submissiveness in a final speech. While scholars make much of how ambivalent the speech might be, suggesting that it could be performed straight or as deeply ironic, Petruchio's public success at wife taming has made him admired by all the other men who look on in wonder at the control he has obtained over Kate. So, regardless of the multivalent potential of the final speech, this play authorizes an oppressive and exploitative hierarchical and patriarchal structure. It is a social world in which the bodies of servants and tinkers are exploited for labor and entertainment. These bodies are the source of a cruel comedy, and they vanish when no longer useful. This is a gendered world where autonomous female voices and bodies are subjected to violence and abuse until they learn to perform submissiveness. So although this play opens as a comedy, I would argue that its ending is tragic.